May the grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us all. It's good to be in worship. It's good to be together. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord. Thank you for joining us for worship on this holiday weekend. It's good to be together, set this time apart to worship the God that has created us and the God that has come to us in the power of Jesus Christ. And the God that just continues to lift us up and heal us by God's Holy Spirit. It's good to be together. And this day, in this time, we gather around this holy table and receive again the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, the grace of God poured out for us in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for being here. It's good to be together. Very special welcome to Alita and Andy. We're glad you're here, and we'll hear more from Andy. Thank you. And a special welcome to Milton, Jackie, you're here again. And Lila and Maya, wave. Hi, we're glad you're here, thank you. And Lucas and Aiden are here, wave. We're glad you're here, thank you. And Franklin and Charlotte and Leonard are here, and we're gonna hear more from them in a few minutes. And David's here, and my good friend Dave Wright is here, enjoying the fruits of retirement and sitting back in the pew to worship with us. Dave is now the retired pastor of the Gettysburg Presbyterian Church. You're always welcome, Dave. We're glad you're here. Okay, you have work to do after worship. You have to sign up. Sign up. If you're a couple, please sign up for the couples group next Saturday night at the Groves House. And we're having a big picnic. In fact, we're just having a little installation service in order to have a picnic on July 17th. So please sign up for that. And then a great event in the life of our church is our church retreat on August 13th. There's a wonderful team of people planning and organizing this. It's a full day at Camp Ader, right down the road in Fairfield, beautiful place. I've been working on my part of it. I'm excited about sharing that with you. So please sign up for our church retreat. And then at the end of August, we're having a new church picture directory taken. Those pictures are 25, 26, and 27 of August. You can sign up online now. And the more of you that do that will help our leaders, Judy and Karen, relax. And that would be important. So please sign up in advance. But in a couple weeks, you'll be able to sign up in person, kind of on paper. So please sign up for the church picnic. Please sign up for the church retreat. And please sign up to be part of the church directory. Thank you for being here. My friends, relax, be comfortable. This service is probably going to be 90 minutes, but that's okay. Tomorrow's a holiday. We have all the time in the world. We're glad you're here. Alicia is our duty elder.
Good morning, everybody. My goodness, the red, white, and blue is everywhere. Happy Independence Day weekend. Hope you enjoy it very much. I do have a few announcements. Naomi's Sisters, which is our widows group, had so much fun last week when we played games. We're doing it more frequently. So widows, please join us on Tuesday the 5th, that's this Tuesday, at 1 o'clock in the fellowship hall, and bring a game if you have one and you especially like, and if we don't know it, we'll learn it. So please come. Pastor already covered his installation and pig roast. I'm not sure which part he's more interested in, but please remember to pick up your newsletter if you have not done so when leaving the church today. Any leftover will, after this service, will be mailed, but each one that is taken is postage that we don't have to use, so please take it. For those who will be watching at home later, we're not live streaming, who are not familiar with our website, you can access the newsletter the order of worship, otherwise known as the bulletin, the hymns, and so on there. It may help you to be prepared at home for the live streaming service. The website is www.lmcpc, Lower Marsh Creek Presbyterian Church.org. And I think we have another announcement. There we are.
I just wanted to let you all know I got a newsletter about the Afghan family after Little Ripples came out. So I thought I'd give you just a brief update. They have a plot at the Ag Center Community Garden, and Mom is really enjoying being able to go and work that garden. In Afghanistan, women only work in the homes doing cooking and cleaning, and the men take care of the outside gardening and other work. So she's really enjoying having that freedom. The children have attended a day camp at the rec park, and now all of the children are enrolled for their grade levels in classes held by Migrant Education, and that's a four-week class. Dad and three of the sons are employed. They're on reduced hours for this summer. I know Dad is working at the dining hall at the college. I'm not sure about the sons, but I suspect they are as well. Several families around West Broadway and West Lincoln Block held a Getting to Know You gathering so that they could meet the neighbors and welcome them there. One of the best ways to get to know them and meet them would be if you completed all the clearances to provide transportation. There is a definite procedure for that. But they need drivers to take them to doctor's appointments, the grocery store, fun events like sports and festivals. So, you know, if you have an interest in that, let me know, and I'll put you in touch with someone with the partnership. Their current needs include someone with website development skills to set up a website, and this is for the partnership. They need committee members for transportation, cultural, housing or furnishings, education, and ESL helpers. They need a scheduling coordinator to help with the transportation needs. If you have an interest in any of that, again, let me know and I will pass it on. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandy. Are there any other announcements? Okay, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. Call upon the Lord.
We ask for help.
Healing and peace are poured out.
We ask for freedom.
We are given liberty beyond measure.
Praise God.
Let us worship God in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us pray. Your word, O Lord, is our inspiration, our light, and our motion. Your word, O Lord, is power, wisdom, and comfort. Guide us today as we listen to the word read and proclaimed. Fill us with understanding. Inspire us with a desire to change. Speak, Lord. Your people listen. Amen.
Have received great gifts in our families, in our lives, in our church, in our nation, and we gather to thank God, mindful of all the gifts and grace that have poured out to us. We're also mindful of our own unworthiness, our need for forgiveness and God's mercy. With that in mind, let's ask again for forgiveness. Let's do that in one voice using our unison prayer. And then please do that individually in your own hearts in silence. Let us pray. Almighty God, we ask for the power of your forgiveness. Fill us with your peace and with your mercy. Free us from the destruction of sin. Restore us to a life lived in you. All things through Christ our Lord. In Christ, amen. My friends, we gather here in the name of Jesus Christ. And we remember, we proclaim again that in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are gathered, and blessed, redeemed, and called. All things in Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join me in the responsive reading of Psalm 30. I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord, my God, I call to you for help, and you heal me. You, Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing the praises of the Lord, you his faithful people. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but your rejoicing comes in the morning. When I felt secure, I said, I will never be shaken. Lord, when you favored me, you made my royal mountain stand firm. But when you hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, Lord, I called. To the Lord, I cried for mercy. What is gain if I am silenced, if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your faithfulness? Hear, Lord, and be merciful to me. Lord, be my help. You turned my wailing into dancing. You removed my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, that my heart may sing your praises and not be silent. Lord my God, I will praise you forever.
Thank you. So proudly we hail as the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. O'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Again, to keep the applause coming.
Thank you.
Amen.
Any children that are here, now I know that some I invited and some are sitting right there with my husband. Come on up, Lucas and Aiden. Here we have Franklin. This is his first appearance up here.
Come on.
And his sister.
All right. Look at
that. Charlotte. Now, Leonard, you want to sit over there for a moment? I'll be there in a minute. Oh, wow. It's a good thing I got lots of flowers.
Stand up.
I have no idea who the rest of you are. Come on up.
Come in front of the table.
Yeah, we're going to stand in front of the table. Right here. You can stand there. Oh, my goodness. This is wonderful. Yes, Mama. Yes, Mama. Oh, yes, two of them. Yes, two of them. I just sat them back there with my husband, and they just sat there like they belong there. Bless their hearts.
Thank you.
God knew that we need kids today to do this. Now, we're going to start with our family section by having Leonard, our younger organist. He's going to play a patriotic song for us to get us started. To God Bless America. A couple of these guys have the words, but they're just going to wave their flags. Kind of wave it on. And you can sing too, of course. Okay. I'm the older organist.
Thank you very much for being here today, and happy 4th of July. You can hold a flag. Go back to your seats. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You want me to take them back? Okay. Thank you, guys. You can have it if you want it. There you go. Good.
They want to preach.
Thank you all for being here. And thank you, Linda, for our 4th of July extravaganza. Thank you. Wonderful day. Let's gather for a moment of prayer. We all bring prayer concerns. Thank you for those of you that are watching this recording of our worship service, but we're going to pause the audio for a moment while we have a time of sharing here in our sanctuary. Are there specific prayer concerns you'd like to share? Situations. Of course, we pray for our nation and the nations of the world this holiday weekend. Let us pray. Eternal God, thank you for the opportunity to gather in church. Thank you for the joy and presence of these beautiful children with us today. Hear our prayers. We pray for Frank and Sandy and the traumatic moments of another car accident and just walk with them through all those details. Thank you for their health and safety. We continue to pray for Peter and England, David's son-in-law, and ask you to move there with grace and healing and peace. We gather here in worship, thankful, grateful for the opportunity to be in this holy place, for the heritage and history that this place stands for, and for the faith that has been passed down to us. Thank you, Lord, for all your grace and goodness. In Jesus Christ, hear our prayers. Amen. Thank you. We turn to Holy Scripture, my friends, on this Sunday morning. First of all, from Paul's letter to the Galatians, picking this up in chapter 6. So read along with me. More importantly, open your hearts to the power of Holy Scripture. Galatians chapter 6, beginning at verse 7. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. Amen. And continuing again this week from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10. A story from the ministry of Jesus, his sending out of the disciples on a mission trip. Luke chapter 10, verses 1 through 20. Read along with me. Hear again the power and glory of our Lord Jesus. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. Jesus told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bags or sandals. Do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If a man of peace is there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you. Stay in that house, eating and drinking and whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, 'The kingdom of God is near you.' But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that sticks to our feet, we wipe off against you.' Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God is near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted up to the skies? No, you will go down to the depths. He who listens to you listens to me. He who rejects you rejects me. But he who rejects me rejects him who sent me." The 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." Jesus replied, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." Amen. There are two great impulses for us in the church. They move in different directions, but they're both very biblical and very important. The first impulse we here in this church do very well is the impulse to gather, to come together, to be together in worship, in prayer and praise, to support one another. The impulse to be here as one church family. We're good at that. The other impulse highlighted in this Bible passage in Luke is the impulse to go out. To go out into this world, strange and foreign, where the people don't really know what we do here, what we believe, why we're here, and to share and proclaim and teach the good news about Jesus. We're not so good at that. We need to work on that. To share, to invite, to go out telling our neighbors, telling our friends, telling our colleagues about what we have in the power of Jesus Christ. So these two great impulses, one to gather, one to go out, both commands from Jesus, examples set by Jesus and his disciples, both examples, directions for us. How are you in your own life? Probably pretty comfortable and pretty good with the coming together part. Maybe frustrated or not quite sure how to proceed with the going out and sharing part. We should work on that. Jesus sends out 72 disciples. It's a fascinating passage. They are now empowered in his name to go out, preach and teach, and to prepare the way for his coming. Many of you, I know, are serious students of the Bible, so I just want to do a quick Bible study on this passage. It's an important passage. It's chapter 10. Remember that. Last week, we talked about chapter 9. In chapter 9, I highlighted last week that Jesus set his mind on going to Jerusalem. It's a turning point in the Gospel of Luke. Before this, in the previous chapters, Jesus had just been walking around, kind of itinerant preaching here and there, small towns, especially way across the Sea of Galilee, out in what would have been the wilderness, and healing and preaching and lots of powerful stories. But then at the beginning of chapter 9, Jesus makes up his mind to go to Jerusalem. We know what that means. He's going to the cross, and nothing will stop him. So a little biblical detective work. So he's on his way to Jerusalem. He sends out these 72 disciples as kind of an advance guard for him. And I wonder, we can't know what Jesus was thinking, what was in his mind. So I'm speculating. But I wonder if he was kind of trying to ascertain how his presence, how his ministry was being received in the land, in the culture, in the air of the time. Were people listening to him? Were people transformed by him? Maybe he wanted to know kind of who was with him as he went to Jerusalem. And the road continues. And this passage is actually a great encouragement to me, because the disciples find out what Jesus already knew, that many, many people, including whole towns of people that he lists, aren't interested. They don't hear. They're not changed. They're not open to this Jesus Christ. Their minds, their hearts, it seems as if their whole town closed to the gospel. That just seems like the world I've been living in my whole career. So many people in so many places in our own land just closed to the gospel. And the church and the gospel of Jesus Christ has had a hard time in this culture of ours for my whole career since the 1980s. So I used the Sunday of the 4th of July holiday in my own mind to reflect a little bit on church in our culture. What's happening? Christianity in our American culture. I can't remember 6 points, so I have some help. 6 points. The church, my whole career, has been in decline. That kind of hurts. Not individual congregations, many of them, like this one, doing quite well. But as Christianity, capital C, kind of church in America, has been in pretty massive decline. When I started my ministry back in the 80s, it was the mainline churches, the Presbyterians and the Methodists and the Episcopalians that were all, the Lutherans were all kind of in decline, and we continue to be. But in the 80s, there was this fabulous new phenomenon of the non-denominational mega churches, and everyone thought, oh, that's the future. And it's all about style, right? And rock and roll and having different kinds of music. And that everyone's going to go there. Guess what's happened? Now it's 2022. All of those churches, the whole phenomenon, also now in decline. Every expression of Christianity in our culture is in decline. What does that mean? How do we think about that? What's happening? I have 3 points that I think are happening in our culture that we have no control over. The church didn't cause it, but we have been sucked up in it. The first I want to call secularization. This is a huge, big concept, much bigger than just not having prayers in schools, not having the Ten Commandments on the courthouse front lawn. It's not about that. It's about being immersed in the presence of God. I'm not a secular person, as most of you are not. I'm a spiritual person. So when I wake up in the morning, like most of you, I bet, you think, wow, it's a new day. The sun's shining. I have work to do. Thanks be to God. It's just an immediate reaction. It's just the air I breathe as a person of faith. But what secularization has done is separated those two things. Most people now, and it is most, will wake up in the morning and something has got disconnected, and there's no awareness of the presence and the power and the gifts of God. How did that happen? That's the world we live in now. We didn't cause that. Secondly, I did something last Sunday afternoon after worship that my parents, my grandparents, my great-grandparents especially would have found absolutely appalling, even sinful. You know what I did? I went to Walmart. And you know what? If I would have stayed long enough, I probably would have seen some of you. I didn't stay very long. What has happened in our time? It's just a restructuring of time. The church didn't cause this. It just kind of happened over a long time. I think it started back in like 1960 with the National Football League, which I love and follow closely, but they have taken Sunday. And now time has been restructured and changed in our society. It's as if there's not enough of it. And so if you don't have in your own flow and structure of time a commitment to church, it's very hard to create that. Many, many, many people love the church, love what we do, love what we believe, but simply don't have time. I don't know what to do about that. That's just been kind of imposed on us in the last 50 years. So be careful. Think about the way you structure your time. And the third kind of cultural phenomenon that's happened to us that has affected the church is this glory we now have for individual freedom. And we all appreciate this. It's the 4th of July. We are the freest people in the world. We have almost complete personal freedom. What a gift. But I believe what has happened in our time is this has swung a little too far. So there's no commitment today, no conversation about, no vision of what our founding fathers called a common good, what we all share together, and that together there are values and convictions and beliefs that we may have to actually sacrifice in order to contribute to. So this profound commitment to individual freedom has swung so far that it's hurt the church, because the church is committed to being together. Those are three things, I wish we could talk more, that I see happening in our culture, that the church, that have just kind of impacted the life of the church that we didn't cause, some of which we actually appreciate, but is the air we now breathe. Secularization, the restructuring of time, and this overarching commitment to personal freedom. I have three more points, and these are things I believe the church can control, things we can do together as a church in this American culture. The first comes from our Presbyterian Book of Order, and I preach this a lot. It's called mutual forbearance. It's the idea born early in our nation. It's the idea that there are different perspectives, different truths, different viewpoints, different points of view, and we need to be able to allow them to coexist. We don't all agree with one another about a whole host and list of issues. And the Christians, the church, needs to be the place where we practice mutual forbearance, that we allow ourselves to disagree with one another about important life-changing convictions without breaking community, to stay together in Christ across our differences. We can do that. It's increasingly difficult in this culture, but we can do that here, and we can do it better. Secondly, we need to preach grace. It's all grace. It's all grace. It's all gift. It's all given. It's all blessing. It's all grace, which means then we need to stop condemning people. We need to stop naming people as rejected or condemned or outside of the kingdom or outside of the faith or beyond our belief. Who are we to say? We need to preach grace and practice grace and acceptance and allow God to do the judging and the condemning. It's not our place. It's all about grace. And thirdly, one thing we can do and we do well, which we can do better, is hospitality. I believe hospitality is the foundation of the gospel message for our culture today. Just welcoming, and inviting people into Christ. But I want us to understand the depth of what hospitality is in the gospel. It's so much more than what we do so well, which is, good morning, it's good to see you, how are you, isn't it a sunny day? Hospitality is about, let me tell you what Jesus has done for me. And I want to listen to what Jesus has done for you. Where do we have those conversations? Where do we share with one another what God has done in our lives and give thanks for that? Or stop when we are just crushed and burdened and ask, will you pray for me? Will you love me? Can I talk to you? That's the hospitality of the gospel. We have here this beautiful spirit of hospitality. It can be deeper and better in Christ. Let's do that. In this culture, in this day, for the 4th of July, these are things the church can do. Mutual forbearance. Preach grace and practice it every day. And hospitality to everyone in the name of Jesus. And a final point for you to just go home with. This decline in the church, the decline of the numbers, the decline of the institution, it's a very good thing. One of the best things that God is doing for us. For maybe we'll get rid of the extraneous kind of conversations and focus authentically on Jesus Christ. That's who we need to be. Amen. For our Lord's Supper Sunday, we use the Apostles' Creed for our affirmation of faith. It's in the front cover of the hymnal, so I don't presume that we have this memorized. So find it. Is it front or back? It is front, not this one. Stand and join me. Maybe it's in the front cover of the hymnal. Stand and join me if you're comfortable standing in our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for being the church and for doing the work of the church in this place. Let's praise God for all that we have received, singing our doxology.
Oh.
generous financial support of our congregation. Let us pray for our church, our ministry, and our mission. Let us dedicate our giving and our service to our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Eternal God, help us to use the gifts you have given us with generosity, love, and wisdom. Inspire us to honor the trust you have put in us, building the church and serving your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
I'll walk with God from this day on. His helping hand I'll lean upon. This is my prayer, my humble plea, that the Lord be ever with me. There is no death, though eyes grow dim. There is no fear when I'm near to him. I lean on him forever, and he'll forsake me never. He will not fail me as long as my faith is strong. Whatever road I may walk along, I'll walk with God, I'll take his hand, I'll talk with God, he'll understand. I'll pray to him each day, to him, and he'll hear the words that I say. His hand will guide my faith and hope, and I'll never walk alone. While I walk with God,
thank you
for being here.
Thank you very much.
Please come again.
This is about Jesus. This is the table of Jesus. This is a gift from Jesus to the church, to us. This is the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. In these little things prepared for us, a touch of bread, a tiny little cup of juice, in these things, grace is poured out. We are blessed and gathered. This is about Jesus. Thanks be to God. The great prayer of thanksgiving is a responsive prayer. It's printed. Please join me. It's a beautiful prayer. Let us pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right. In our great delight to praise you, O God. In the beginning of time, your wisdom danced through creation, calling forth light and life. Through wisdom, you formed us in your image, calling us to love and serve you. Foolishly, we turned from you and abandoned your ways of justice and mercy. Yet you did not reject us, but continued to call us and claim us as your own. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels and with all the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name.
Holy,
holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of power and might, and blessed is Jesus Christ, the one who comes in your name. In his life, he called unlikely people to follow him. Fisher folk, tax collectors, children, sinners, deniers, betrayers. On the cross, he gave himself up to the powers of this world, showing in his body your great foolishness, O God, for loving such a wayward world. Yet by this very cross, O wisdom from on high, you have undone and remade the wisdom of this world, drawing light from darkness, power from humiliation, life from death itself. Remembering your gracious acts in Jesus Christ, we proclaim together the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Come then, life-giving spirit, brood over these bodily things and make us into one body with Christ, that we who are baptized into his death may walk in newness of life, that what is sown in dishonor may be raised in glory, and what is sown in weakness may be raised in power. We praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. My friends, we remember Jesus. We remember the day before his crucifixion. He gathered with his disciples in an upper room. They had prayed together. They had eaten together. And after their meal, Jesus lifted up a simple, common loaf of bread. He broke it, and he said to them and to us, "This is my body broken for you." Every time you eat this, eat it and remember me. In the same way, after their meal, Jesus lifted up a common cup, saying to his disciples, saying to us, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Every time you drink this, drink it and remember me." Gathered here around this table in our church in the name of Jesus, we share these gifts and we remember, we proclaim, we celebrate again all that God has done for us in Jesus Christ. Let's share the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. There is a gluten-free bread available if you just indicate to one of the servers. Please.
Jesus said,
I am the vine, you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Amen. There's a printed prayer for after communion. Please join me. Let us pray. God of abundance, with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ. Make us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love in this world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We only sing this hymn once a year, and if you ponder the words carefully, you'll see that it's actually a prayer. Let's pray it to the Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for joining us for worship this day. I remind you, on Communion Sundays, our choral response is the church song, Stone by Stone. Some of you are still learning that. The words are printed.
Now open your hands, open your hearts to this most glorious of benedictions from the book of Numbers. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.